ده مولد نبوي. وقت مسألة صار فيها الخلاف. I have found no single Shafi'i faqih that condemns the maulid. I have found some Shafi'i fuqaha who condemn elements associated with the maulid while affirming the validity of the maulid. Taking it back to Imam Shafi'i's own words, al-muhdathatu ala darbayn. Innovations, to call it innovations, there are two kinds of them. That which is in line with what Sharia says and that which is not in line with what Sharia says. So that is now essentially your bid'ah hasan, your bid'ah sayyah. It forms part of the usul framework of what the Shafi'i madhab is all about, which is why I haven't found a single Shafi'i faqih to condemn the maulid as such. The maulid was, they admit the fact that the maulid is a bid'ah. That cannot be denied. But they say, well, it's a bid'ah hasana. What makes it hasana, what makes it sayyah, depends what you put into the maulid. If you put aqaid kufriya into the maulid, it becomes a bid'ah sayyah. If you keep it free from that and you keep it as it was in the time of Imam Nawawi's Ustad Abu Shama, he's the first one. He wrote the book against bid'ah. Al-Ba'ith ala inkari al-bid'ah wal-hawadith. And he takes his methodology from Izzuddin ibn Abd al-Salam, his teacher, who laid out that al-bid'ah ala khamsati aqsam. You get a bid'ah wajiba, you get a bid'ah manduba, you get a bid'ah mubaha, and makruha, and muharrama. All four, five of these you do get. And then he says, وَمِنْ أَحْسَنِ مَبْتُدِعَ فِي زَمَانِنَا الْمَوْلِدِ النَّبَوِي. He says that's a bid'ah hasana. So, if we're looking at this from the point of view of the Shafi'i madhab, this is what how the Shafi'i fuqaha have treated it. Many of them have written mawalid themselves. Ibn Hajar has a famous answer that he gave, Suyuti quotes it. Suyuti has a risala on it, what does he call it? حُسْنُ الْمَقْصِدِ فِي عَمَلِ الْمَوْلِدِ. Sakhawi has written a mawlid, Ibn Kathir has written a mawlid. But in back then, all of them, Ibn Nasir al-Din and so on, what was a mawlid to them? A mawlid was an occasion to celebrate the seerah and to discuss the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Last year, the year before, I bought the mawlid of Ibn Nasir al-Din. Now, Ibn Nasir al-Din al-Dimashqi is also the man who wrote that other book, Ar-Radd al-Wafir ala man za'ama. أن من قال في ابن تيمية شيخ الإسلام فهو كافر. He's defending Ibn Taymiyyah. So, and he writes a mawlid. So his mawlid is called Jami' al-Athar fi mawlidi al-Mukhtar. I want to see what his mawlid. His mawlid comes in 6 volumes. So I want to see what his mawlid. What is it? It's a book on seerah. Not just the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His birth, his life, his death, his clothing, it's like shama'il, it's seerah, all of that included. So the mawlid was an occasion of reconnecting with the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Similarly would be the mawlid of Sakhawi, the mawlid of Ibn Kathir and so on. But back then, mawlids were written in the form of what? In the form of hadith books, history books. Then later on, mawlid assumed a different form. In the time of Barzanji, in the time of Ibn Daybah, it assumed a different form now. Now mawlids were written in literary form, no longer in hadith form. Ibn Nasir al-Din would say, you know, أخرج البخاري عن فلان and he gives the hadith. Or, you know, أخرج البيهقي في الدلائل and he would give the hadith. Later on, the mawlid doesn't sound like that any longer. The mawlid sounds what? أبتدي الإملاء باسم الذات العلية. Father is shaking his head. He probably knows the mawlid by heart. So it assumes a literary form. And in this literary form, this is the mawlid that we have come to know in our societies. That's the mawlid. And that mawlid is then restricted to that particular night of the 12th of Rabiul Awal when it is read. Or to the month of Rabiul Awal, throughout the month of Rabiul Awal when that mawlid is read. The reading of the mawlid, you know, of the events, recollecting the events, what is the harm therein? It's like a jalsa of seerah. Having a jalsa speaking about the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But when the events are based upon mawdu ahadi, then we have a bit of a problem with that. And the later mawalid do not actually indicate what their sources are. There's a second thing, and that is the qiyam inda dhikr al-mawlid. Falamma tamma min hamlihi ala al-rajih 9 ashhurin qamariya, and then fawaladathu ummuhu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qamaran yatala'la'u sana. This man's face is shining. He knows all about it. And at that moment, everyone gets up and sallallahu ala Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That qiyam is a mas'ala fiqhiyya. قيام إذا مسألة فقهية ومسألة اختلف فيها فقهاء المذهب الشافعي. The Shafi فقهاء ابن حجر هيثم من الفتاوى حديثية treats that particular مسألة and he calls it a بدعة شنيعة منكرة. He says that's not a بدعة حسنة. That قيام عند ذكر المولد بدعة شنيعة منكرة. He treats it where he comes, you know, he's asked the question, there's a hadith which says when which surah was it? أتى أمر الله فلا تستعجل. When there's revealed to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, then he stood up. So someone asked, if we read today, Ata Amrullah, can we also stand up? you know, for the sake of ta'asib in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says, no, you cannot. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood up there when, it said, when the ayah came to Ata Amrullah. So he thinks Qiyamah has come now. When came Fala Tastajiru, he sits down again. So the Madi is for not for tahqeeq, but for ta'keed. Ata Amrullah, not it has come, it will most certainly come. So he sits down again. So the sabab for the Qiyam existed for a very short space of time and then it's gone. So he sat down. So from there he goes on and says, the standing at the time of Dhikrul Mawlid, this is bid'ah shani'a munkara. Some of the mutaakhirin in Hijaz afterwards and in Yemen, they have said that no, it's amr mustahsan. They didn't find it as bad as that. So it's a masala of ikhtilaf between the ulama. Personally, I'm much more inclined to the view of Ibn Hajar. Well, if the qawaid of ifta in the madhab are to be considered like we laid it out previously, then the view of those mutaakhirin doesn't really hold water against his view. But there are some fuqaha who have said so. And then they will quote certain things. They will quote the incident of Yam Sukki rahmatullahi alayhi when Ibn Sasri's qasida was recited in front of him. قَلِيلٌ لِحَظِّ الْمُصْطَفَى الْخَطُّ بِالذَّهَبِ عَلَى وَرِقٍ مِّنْ خَطِّ أَحْسَنِ مَنْ كَتَبْ وَأَيَّنْهَضَ الْأَشْرَافُ عِنْدَ سَمَاعِهِ. And Sukki stood up and everyone else stood up. فَحَصَلَ أُنْسٌ كَبِيرٌ. Everyone felt very good. So they say, well, Sukki stood up so we can also stand up. That was waqi'at hal, one particular incident. And we don't say Sukki sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We say Sukki rahimahullah. He's not a Nabi. And he did it under the impulse of the moment. There are times, and you know, when one listens very carefully to the Mawlid of Barzanji being recited, and you know the language, and you're following the recitation, when that moment of the Mawlid is actually mentioned, you can feel a very strong urge to do something. You want to do something. Now, whether you're going to hit a cartwheel, or you're going to laugh or cry, but some people express it in the sense of standing up. Now, if they do it under that particular force of sentiment at that moment, that would be similar to Sukki. But if they're standing up simply because this is the ritual, when once the bid'ah hasana becomes ritualized, then it starts assuming dimensions that are somewhat questionable now. After ritualization, when the bid'ah hasana not ritualized only, but elevated to the level of the wajib, in the sense that, oh, you don't stand up, therefore you hate Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or you don't make the mawlid, and therefore you disrespectful Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not a wajib. It's a bid'ah. It's tolerable in that sense. But when the bid'ah hasana reaches those proportions, then the very first person to condemn it would be the very same fuqaha who have approved of it. So they will approve of it within certain limits. And they will disapprove of it when it crosses those lines. They would have disapproved of it. In their time, it didn't quite reach those limits. It was only afterwards. And there Ibn Hajar could speak about it. He had seen one thing which he condemned. But as for the Mawlid in general, he says it's fine. He's got this book called An-Ni'matul Kubra al-Alam Bimawlidi Sayyidi Waladi Adam. And in there he discusses what the people of Makkah, where he used to live, what they do on the night of Mawlid. And they all go to the place of where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. But then he condemns some of the things which they do, men and women and everyone else, and said that is wrong. So those aspects of the Mawlid which are condemnable will be condemned. The Mawlid itself in essence was not condemned. But fi'luhu wa tarkuhu sawa. Those who do it are good, those who do not do it, there's no blame against them either. I just think that Mawlid in our society sometimes have been taken completely out of context. It has been made a mas'ala of tafsiq and tabdi' and all of these kind of things which shouldn't necessarily be. Those of us who are in control, those of us who have the manabid and the maharif, should make islah of these rusum. Reform these rusum to bring it in line with what the sharia would demand. But this kind of islah will not come about by condemnation. Condemnation only breeds opposition. When you condemn, you don't reform, you just make the opposition more determined to continue with it exactly as is. So if it could be brought in line, if there's something wrong with it, condemn what is wrong, leave the rest. And that's where I speaking in light of what the madhab says, that's where I would leave it.